Let us go into the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen. So I want to welcome you all to a Harvest Christian Center midweek service. Resurgent service. Amen. I believe God's going to revive us, refresh us, and renew us. Amen. And I am your CRO, your chief reminding officer. And God want to use you this week. He want to use you this month. He want to use you this year. We want to use you to distribute love and be a peacemaker. Amen. God says, blessed are the peacemakers, so they shall be called the children of God. Amen. Blessed are the peacemakers, you shall be called the children of God. Amen. How many excited about being in the house of the Lord?
Amen.
I am excited. I want you, since you're excited, please invite someone to Sunday service. I was excited to look at the numbers for this past Sunday. I think we had 179 people in the across the worship services. That was awesome, and I'm very excited about what God is doing. And today, after the word, we will have a time at the altar of prayer. So if you need prayer for anything, be prepared to come after the teaching tonight. Amen. I'm glad you're excited because we're getting ready to raise the offering. Amen. Amen. I want to keep that excited for the offering and the worship. Amen. Our offering scripture tonight is Genesis 28, 20 through 22. And it reads, when Jacob made a vow, saying, if God, or since God, will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking, and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear, so that I will return safely to my father's household, then the Lord shall be my God. And this stone that I have set up as a pillar will be God's house. And of all that he give me, I will give you a tenth. Amen. Amen. Jacob recognized who is his provider, where his help came from. Amen. He showed his appreciation by giving him a tenth of everything that God gave him. Let us pray. Father, we truly thank you that we're here in the house of God one more time. We thank you for being our provider, the one that gave us to clothe ourselves, meet the needs of our family. We thank you for providing for this house, your house. Lord, I pray as we give tonight, we give with thanksgiving in our heart. And Lord, we pray that the rest of the service, that you be in the midst, that we give you praise, worship, that be a sweet savor to you, God. Lord, we thank you for what you been doing, and thinking what you're going to do tonight and what you're going to do in the future through us, in us.
here during the first service, you know this woman. And at the second service, I thought, wow, I got to do that next Sunday. So, nonetheless, let me encourage you tonight, if you have a Bible with you, open up to the book of Hebrews. And the first, if you wrote anywhere, let's start with about Hebrews 9, because I'm going to take some points out of the book of Hebrews. And I want to tell those of you who are serious Bible students something, and go ahead and make a confession. Preachers, pastors, Bible teachers are guilty often of what I'm about to describe to you. We're taught, somewhat educated, but we're taught a framework, a system of theology. And therefore, after we're taught that framework, what we typically do every time we read the Bible is we take that framework and we lay it down on top of Scripture. And we try to make everything we read in the Bible fit the framework, our system of theology. And that turns into error because it causes you to not really take the cultural context, the literary context, and you don't really get a good interpretation of Scripture if you try to force it into your framework. What I'm trying to explain to you as a good Bible student, you need to let Scripture speak for itself.
Amen.
If it lines up with what you already previously were taught and believed, that's right. If not, guess who needs to be right? The Word of God is always right. And tonight, I just want to confess to you, I bring to you just a simple message, but the Lord stirred my heart about it, and it's just the Scripture speaking to us. And I want to talk to you tonight about not without these three. Not without these three. A wise man once said, a man is rich not by what he owns, but what he can live without. Think about that. I'm going to say it again. A man is rich not by what he owns, but by what he can live without. I don't know about you, but the longer I live on this side of eternity, the more I'm convinced that there's a lot of things in this world I could live without. I mean, if I really stop and think about it, and I'm not a lavishly wealthy man, you learned that when I first showed up a couple of years ago. But, you know, if I look at my own wardrobe, I could probably do without about half of my wardrobe. I like technology, I like electronics, but I could probably do without most of the, I could live without it, right? You know, we lived before it existed, well, some of us did. Y'all did too, right? Do y'all remember when we had church and we didn't have fancy screens? Listen, when I first started, it was the overhead projector. But even before that, when we just actually held a hymn book to sing, you know, and now we can't even hardly remember the words to a song. And I'm not trying to tell you I want to go back to those days. I like my technology, but if I had to, I could live without it. And the same is true about a lot of things in this world. I just believe I could live without. I mean, come on, couldn't you live without the bad attitudes of some of your family members? Couldn't you live without the many temptations to sin that you encounter on a daily basis? Somebody say amen. Is it true or not? Could you do it? Could you live without the spiritual warfare of the adversary of your soul? Wouldn't it be nice to just have a few weeks break from that? Like, devil, leave me alone. Not today. Not this week. I'm taking a season off from fighting with you. And nonetheless, we find that he is a persistent adversary for our souls. Those are some of the things I could live without. But what I want to tell you tonight is that the Bible teaches us that there are three things that we cannot live without. Well, let me be clear here. You can live without them, but it would just be a brief, meager existence. For any child of God that really wants the abundant life that Christ wants you to have, you cannot live without these three. So, the Bible is clear. I know many of us have been taught so much about the Bible, and I try to keep that in mind when I come to you on Wednesdays, that I need to be a little, maybe not so simple, because, you know, some of you have been studying the Bible and reading the Bible longer than I've been alive, and that's a good thing. And I know you need to be fed well from the Scriptures. You need well thought out doctrine. But what I want to say to you at the beginning of this is that I need you to keep in mind, as we go through the future of Harvest Christian Center, we're reaching people who are so unchurched that they do not know the most basic of Bible stories. So my preaching is probably not going to get more complicated. It's probably going to get more simple on Sundays, because I really want to see people get saved by the grace of God. Okay?
Yeah.
I'm not looking to impress you, and I'm not looking to confuse them with my Bible knowledge. It's good that I have it, and I know usually a whole lot more than what I bring in. I mean, let me just explain to you, give you an analogy to help you understand that. When I sit down to eat a meal that Sister Lisa has prepared, I really don't care about all the technique that it took and all the seasoning. So I want to know, does it taste good, you know? And if it tastes good, I eat it and I leave and I'm happy. And I think that's the way the average person is when they come to church. But here's the thing. A lot of people come to our church and they've never really been taught much about salvation. They've never been taught much about salvation, about the Bible, and what it means to go to heaven. I know that's not true about most of you. Most people who come to a midweek service have already been well indoctrinated about what it means to go to heaven, to be saved by the grace of God. But listen, regardless of what you've been told and who told it to you, if it doesn't line up with Scripture, you need to toss it out. I know that seems somewhat offensive, but I tell you, based on what I'm about to share with you, that if what you've learned about salvation and going to heaven don't line up with these three, then I tell you, get rid of it and adopt these three. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Hebrews chapter 9 is where we're going to start. But let me share with you Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 12. Maybe you recognize this verse of Scripture. It says, though a man might prevail against one who is alone, two will withstand him. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Will you say that last part with me? A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Well, tonight, I want to explain to you that if you will grab a hold of the threefold cord that I want to share with you, then you can have a salvation from God that holds you tighter than your ability to hold on to it. This threefold cord that I'm about to share with you is actually the threefold cord, I believe in my heart of hearts, for your salvation and your daily walk with God. We started Hebrews 9:22 to allow the Scripture to speak to us. Hebrews 9:22 says, and according to the law, almost all things are purified with blood, and without shedding of blood there is no remission. Without shedding of blood, there is no remission. Now let's place this verse of Scripture in context. In Hebrews, remember we've studied through the book of Hebrews. Matter of fact, we were doing pretty good with Hebrews until we had the great COVID crisis of 2020, and it forced us out of this campus. I remember having to do the last few, two or three lessons from the book of Hebrews, you know, from my office or from my house one night. Had to do that in live stream, so maybe you did catch up, maybe you didn't catch up. Let me explain the context of Hebrews 9:22. Remember, the writer is writing to a bunch of people who are Hebrew. See how simple?
Mm-hmm.
They're Hebrews, and they've converted to Christianity, but they're struggling with Christianity, and they're actually thinking about leaving this thing about following the Lord Jesus Christ and going back to Judaism. Remember, these are people who have been raised in religion. They are steeped with their knowledge of the Mosaic Law and the Levitical priesthood, and they understand every metaphor that this writer brings to them. You and I struggle a little bit with it because, after all, when you went to church last Sunday, you didn't have to sacrifice any livestock, right? You pray because you recognize that if I've done wrong, I can look to Jesus. He will forgive me. That's the grace of God. And therefore, the writer is telling them, according to the law, you know the law, they knew the law very well, all things are purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. Now, typically, when we preachers, we quote that, we always add these two words to the end of that. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. This is the reality. We know that's what the context of the Scripture is talking about, because the writer is telling them, listen, you no longer have to sacrifice any animals, because the blood of Jesus Christ is the perfect Lamb of God. That blood is the once for all sacrifice that washes away all your sins once and for all. Praise God for the sacrifice of Jesus Christ as the Lamb of God. That ought to get you excited just a little bit. The blood of Jesus is so powerful that he never has to go back again. There never has to be another sacrifice. Glory to his name. However, I find that a lot of blood-bought, blood-covered people still got some problems with living right. Pastor John, in his eloquence Sunday morning, made mention of some unbelieving believers. And I would tell you, after so long, God's much more gracious and merciful than I am, because after so long, when I see unbelieving believers carrying on and there's no divine fruit in Let me make this nice and pretty before you get under conviction too much. Now, I've never known anybody who goes to the Krispy Kreme store and says, you know what, I'm just coming to take a look around. I'm going to shop. If you see me in Krispy Kreme, whether I got a donut in my hand or not, know this, I've come there to have a donut. I didn't come to piddle. I don't just like the smell of them. I want to taste them. It smells enough and it'll run your sugar up, right? When you walk to the Krispy Kreme shop, you can smell the sugar in the air. My sugar's going up right now. Just think about it. And you can smell it, but taste of it is so much better. You know, nobody goes to the Krispy Kreme shop and they just sit there and say, you know, I just come to look. I've heard men say, well, you know, looking never hurt nothing. Nobody goes into the Krispy Kreme shop just to say, hey, you know, I just like their coffee. It's good coffee here. Yeah, right. That high octane stuff is just meant to wash it down so you can get the next donut into your mouth. Amen? But maybe you'd say, you know, I've got willpower. And just to prove it to you, I'm going to the Krispy Kreme shop and I'll not have a donut. I'm just going to look around. Guess what? The longer you look, the more apt you are to step up to the counter and make your purchase. And before you know it, if you're anything like me, before you can get out the exit, you've had a donut, maybe three, right? Especially if they're just the plain, the fresh, they just come off. You watched them come off the roller and they go into that grease bath and you watched all the glaze coat them. Oh, you better believe I'm going to have one before I can get out of there. Yeah. If I've already been standing in there and I've been looking at them, I've been watching them because we're focusing on the wrong thing. Church, we cannot be focusing within ourselves thinking that we've got the power somehow, the willpower to overcome and conquer the temptations to sin. There is some place you have to look for help. You've got to look to something. You've got to look to someone who is greater than you, and his name is Jesus. And by the blood of Jesus Christ, we are more than conquerors. We are overcomers. So when you find yourself struggling to live right, you're dealing with temptations to sin, don't look within. Look up. Look to the Lord from whence your help comes. Understand the same blood of Jesus Christ which saved you by the grace of God, you know your past sins are forgiven, is the same blood to give you the power to deal with the present temptations of this world. I'm telling you, we need to look to the Lord and think about the shed blood of Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. His grace is so rich. If we ever grab a hold of the concept of the blood of Jesus Christ being applied to our life, the riches of his grace that brought this to us, then you and I would be walking around all the time thinking, I'm rich, I'm rich, I'm filthy rich. Why? I'm rich according to the grace of God. The blood of Jesus Christ has been applied to my life. Glory to his name. I'm forgiven of my sins. But the world that we're living in, rather than look to the blood of Jesus Christ, the only solution that's ever redeemed a person, spends untold amounts of money trying to reform sinners, trying to fix people. We put them through a correctional system if they get bad enough. We send them to counseling. We send them to support groups. And there's nothing wrong with that, okay? I'm okay with some of that stuff. But listen, the only power that can redeem your soul, forgive you of your sins, and give you the power to resist temptation is the shed blood of Jesus Christ. If I think about the current environment, which has reared its ugly head again, right now in our nation, on a high level, we're dealing with the sins of racism. This is where you might get quiet, but you need to get right if you get too quiet, okay? The deal is, some of us can't get past the skin issue of racism, but I'm telling you, racism is much deeper than your skin. It's a sin issue. It's a sin issue. I'm not trying to oversimplify. I understand that racism is not a simple issue, but I'm telling you, it is a sinful issue. For anybody who claims to be born again by the shed blood of Jesus Christ, you need to understand something. The blood knows no color. The blood crosses all color lines. Thank God for his goodness. I'm telling you tonight, without the effectiveness and the efficiency of Jesus' shed blood, your soul has no comprehensive coverage. You think you're saved and going to heaven when you die? Not without the blood of Jesus.
Right.
Not without the blood of Jesus. Let's turn over in our Bibles. You're at Hebrews 9. Now go to Hebrews 11 and look at verse 6. Hebrews 11, verse 6 tells us, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he always comes by faith. Read the Old Testament, read the New Testament. I tell you, it's always by faith. You got to believe that God is and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. When it comes to salvation, Romans 5:1 sets down the account for us. It says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Justified by faith. Now, this describes the actual legal transaction that takes place in heaven when the blood of Jesus Christ has been applied to your account. You've got the righteousness of Christ applied to your account. By faith, you're saved. You've got peace with God. You were at war. You were at enmity with God. But now, by the shed blood of Jesus Christ being applied to your account, you placed your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now you've got peace with God. But I simply want to tell you tonight, the same faith, the same grace that saved your soul is good for daily living.
Amen.
Let no one fool you, and I hope I've never deceived you in this manner. Just because you've prayed a salvation prayer at the end of one of our Sunday services does not mean, you know, that everything's okay. No. I've worded that salvation prayer in such a manner that any sinner that prays through that with me ought to realize that when I leave here, I'm changed, I'm different, and I got to live like it.
Come on,
you see, repentance starts in the place of prayer, but then you got to stop doing the bad stuff, right?
Yeah.
How do you do that? By the grace of God. God will help us. When we sincerely and genuinely pray a prayer of repentance and forgiveness, the Lord helps us to stop all the stuff that was wicked, that was sinful, that was against his grace. So don't ever think that I think that just praying the prayer is the whole deal. Listen, we believe that the grace of God is working a powerful regeneration inside the sinner's heart. That individual has been born again, and just like any babe, when it's born, it has to grow. This is why we encourage, hey, let us know if you got saved today. If you know you prayed that prayer, you meant it. We encourage, let us know. Let us know on the Connect card. Why? Because every time, me and Pastor John know, every time I get to sit down with somebody, I'm discipling them a little bit more. And the more I can talk to them about the Lord, the more Pastor John gets to talk to them, the more we see them growing in Christ. We see them continue the process that they have begun in. It's called Next Steps. We need your help with that. Make sure that anybody that you see in church on Sunday, you know they prayed the prayer, you feel like something dynamic happened in their soul, encourage them to fill out a Connect card and let us know so that we can follow up with them. Listen, if people come in that are brand new and never fill out a Connect card, if they get saved and walk out, we can't follow up with them. If I can't follow up with them, it's like they never even showed up. There's a divine responsibility God has placed upon your staff that we have to follow up with people to help them because, you know, we just got to have help. I explained this to my children, and I love to tease my daughter Brittany, as most of you may know. I tell her sometimes, you know, you was a mess when we first got you home from the hospital. You couldn't even feed yourself. And that's the thing about new baby Christians, okay? They're a mess. They still make a mess. But you got to feed them, and you got to help them grow, amen? So, listen. Here's the thing, if you are really saved by the grace of God, though, you've got peace with God, and God wants you to have peace here. Remember we talked about that just a couple of Sundays ago, the Lord wants you to have peace here.
Yes.
Peace is not something that you're just looking forward to when you get to eternity. God wants you to be able to experience a measure of his peace right here, right now. Anybody here ever had a good court? And in every courtroom across America, you will find that there are officers of the law stationed. You know what they're there for? To keep the peace. Because they understand that judge has a set of rules for his or her courtroom. And if you disobey those rules, you're out of order. And you're not keeping the peace. And they're going to make sure that you understand when you've disobeyed those rules. If you don't believe me, go down to the county courthouse tomorrow and just try to do whatever you want to do. Throw a fit in the judge's courtroom. And whether you're supposed to be there or not, they will lock you up. You will be fined in contempt of court. You'll either pay a fine, and if you persist, they'll make sure to lock you up and let you sit and think about it for the next 24 hours. But you see, the officer is there to help you to understand the judge has got rules, and they expect you to abide by their rules as long as you are in their courtroom. And you and I understand something. If I'm in that courtroom, I understand they got rules. I understand the reality of what the judge will do. All they got to do is look over and give the right notion to the officer, and they'll take care of me. They may even forcefully remove me. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
And any sane person in their mind, right mind, if they're in that courtroom, they recognize that and they regardless of their feelings of frustration, regardless of the fact that judge may rule against you, if things may not be in your favor on that day, regardless of all that, you understand, I still got to keep my peace. Why? You understand this because you're a sane person. My feelings have to match up to my faith. I may not like it. I may not feel right about what's going on, but you know what? I don't want to be locked up. I don't want to have to pay a fine. Therefore, I'm going to cooperate and I'm going to keep my peace. Somebody needed to hear that tonight. You just need to keep your peace, okay? You can trust the God of heaven and earth to do right. Hasn't He always done right by you? Even when it didn't feel right. What are you saying, preacher? This faith that saved you is faith that you need to live by. You make sure your feelings match up to your faith. You got to take your feelings and look at the facts of God's Word. And if your feelings don't line up with the facts of God's Word, guess which one wins? The facts of God's Word. I place my faith in the facts of God's Word, not the feelings that I'm having. My feelings are horrible liars. They lie to me almost every day. Anybody going to get up tomorrow morning, your feelings going to lie to you? Feelings may say, you don't feel like getting up. I used to see how many people were really, you know, really devout, because a lot of times on Sunday mornings, people don't feel like getting up and going to church, right? Guess what happens if you don't, you know, just tell yourself to get up? You get into those feelings. Now, if you're legitimately sick, you got some COVID issues going on, don't come to church Sunday, okay? I ain't stupid or nothing. I mean, I'm not trying to cause this thing to spread, but at the same time, I'm not fearful. I trust God. I'll use wisdom. I'll walk in faith, but I'm not going to walk around being afraid, and I'm not going to give in to my feelings. I'm just trying to remind you simply tonight, don't give in to your feelings. We are commanded by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, have faith in God.
Yes.
Have we forgotten that God is a healer?
Yes.
Have we forgotten that God is the God of the impossible? I'm simply asking you tonight, believe that our God is still the God of the impossible. In spite of all the turmoil going on in our nation, we are people of prayer that can pray and have faith in God and believe in God to turn it around.
Amen.
I love what Hebrews 10:38 says. There God says, the just shall live by faith, but if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him. Simply leave that verse of scripture alone and tell you that if you don't live by faith in God and you're simply walking by your feelings and getting your feelings hurt all the time, you need to put your faith in God. Okay? When you draw back and you stop living by faith, God says, my soul has no pleasure in you. God's not pleased. That's where we started at on this point here, with this knock. You think you're saved and going to heaven when you die? Not without biblical faith. Let's move further into the book of Hebrews. And I'll take you into Hebrews chapter 12, just one chapter over. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. Now, if you grew up where I was growing up, learning how to preach, you had to memorize this one. I mean, if we weren't against tattoos then, they would have told me to tattoo it on my forehead. I mean, they really wanted it imprinted and engraved upon my soul. This is just like, you know, Holiness Preacher 101. You got to know this verse of scripture. Hebrews 12:14 says, pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. Now, just in case you think this holiness is only New Testament doctrine, let me encourage you to understand the Old Testament. Leviticus chapter 11, verse 44. For I am the Lord your God. You shall, therefore, consecrate yourselves, and you shall be holy, for I am holy. Neither shall you defile yourselves with any creeping thing that creeps on the earth. Now, let me give you a little holiness 101 doctrine here for tonight. Don't misinterpret Old Testament verses of Scripture and try to understand holiness. We have a New Testament. You do better to understand the New Testament doctrine of holiness if you have a basic understanding of the Old Testament doctrine of holiness. But if we just go to the Old Testament, what we do is we misinterpret it, and we place ourselves in legalism. We take things all out of context, culturally and literally, and we blow it. Okay? But here's what I want you to understand. Holiness is still God's standard. Whether we like it, whether we were hurt by it in the past, But this holiness does not start on the outside. It starts on the inside. And if I really got it on the inside, I'm growing in the grace and knowledge of my Lord and Savior, and this holiness begins to manifest itself in the way I live, in the conduct with which I carry myself in the normal, everyday walk of life. Did you notice how Leviticus used this phrase, consecrate yourselves? That doctrine also carries into the New Testament, and we're told to sanctify ourselves. Now, let me explain to you. This biblical holiness I'm talking to you about, God's holiness, was placed on your account at salvation. When the blood of Jesus was applied to your account and you're justified by faith, there's righteousness. The righteousness of Christ was placed on your account. Your righteousness that you had before that was filthy. It was like stinking rags. It's turned God's hand. God couldn't stand it. So he had to do something. When he forgave you of your sins, the blood of Jesus, whom you just placed your faith in, covered your account. And the holiness of God was placed on your account. So that means you're justified. And what we have a responsibility to do as believers in Christ is take what God has applied to us and appropriate it and live it out on a daily basis. What I'm telling you is anybody that really understands salvation, they've been saved for a few years, they're growing in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they're walking in holiness. If not, if there's no divine fruit, then there will be a fire to burn up the dead branches. Now, I'm a preacher of grace, okay? I preach so much grace because God's given me so much grace and given me so many chances. But I'm telling you, at the end of our lives, there will either be divine fruit from beautiful branches, or there will be a divine judgment of fire over dead branches. A lot of people pretend that they are not what they pretend to be. They're simply wearing a mask, if I could borrow another preacher's preaching. They're simply wearing a mask. There's the need to take upon ourselves the personal responsibility of holiness. And please, believe me, I'm not talking about clothes. If I was bound up in the traditions of holiness that I was raised in, grew up around as a young preacher, I would not even think about getting on this platform without a three-piece suit and a full tie. And I would try to find some more clothes to put on. Okay? I've been set free. I'm not bound in tradition. And I'm not talking about the way any of you are dressing. I'm talking about the way we live. There is the fruit of holiness that should manifest itself in our conduct as believers in Jesus Christ. Yes. Let me explain it to you like this. In our nation's war against terrorism, we begin to invoke special forces. We had the Army Rangers, the Green Berets, the Navy SEALs, the Delta Force, and these are all just special people who are set apart from the whole general services, armed services that we have. What about them? Well, I need to tell you about these individuals. They are a cut out from, but also a cut above the rest. Yeah. Anybody understand anything about the military? You understand exactly what I'm talking about. You don't mess with a Green Beret. You don't get on the nerves of a Navy SEAL. These dudes are bad, okay? And I mean bad in a good way. They mean business. They are a cut out from and a cut above the rest. But similarly, we as children of God must understand that we are supposed to be the sanctified people of God. We're cut out from the world and we're supposed to be a cut above the rest. Am I trying to say that Christians are better than the rest of the world? Yes, my friends, but only because of the worthiness and the grace and the shed blood of Jesus Christ. God says you are my peculiar people. You're my special people. I've called you out from among those nations. Yes, we're special in the eyes of God. I'll tell any sinner this, and I'll tell you this. You need to be careful how you treat people who are the special people of God. People who are actually walking in holiness, they're sanctified. You don't want to treat them mean and rough too persistently because the hand of God's judgment will come upon your life. I've seen it happen in individuals. So what I'm telling you, we are supposed to be like the sanctified army of God. We're daily doing battle against the ungodly things of this world. Or to put it in the language of Titus 2, verses 11 and 12. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteous, and godly in this present age. In this world in which you and I live in, I'm telling you, God still has a standard, and that standard is holiness. You think you're saved and going to heaven when you die? Not without God's holiness. In closing, simply tell you this, judgment must first begin at the house of God. If we're going to judge anybody, we need to judge ourselves first. And even when we judge ourselves, we'll recognize, you know what? Maybe I'll pray for them. Maybe I won't judge them. The Holy Spirit reminded me of this verse of Scripture this week. Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. What's he talking about? Well, Jesus ain't called none of us to go into any house and turn over tables. Everybody always wants to bring up that one exception, but Jesus went to church and he flipped the money changers' tables. Okay, but you ain't Jesus.
Come on.
If you've totally perfected holiness, maybe you know, but something tells me that even if you're as sanctified as you could possibly be, that on this side of eternity, maybe you're still not qualified to do some of the things that Jesus did. You see, what Jesus really taught his followers is that we turn the cheek, that we forgive even as we've been forgiven. So when Jesus says this about violence, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence and the violent take it by force, he's talking about the power of prayer. You mad? You angry? Take it to God in prayer. God can handle it. You want to find your anger diffused? Begin to pray to God about it. Tell God how mad you are about people sinning against you and how mad you are about people doing this and hurting others. And then you just might hear the Holy Spirit begin to remind you how often you've sinned against him, how often you've hurt others, and he yet continues to show you mercy and apply grace to your life. I want to invite you to a time of prayer tonight. The scripture gives us this invitation. We have a mandate not just to be believers, but to be people of prayer. We are told in the book of Hebrews to come boldly unto the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. If you would stand with me. Before I invite you to join me in these altars, blood of Jesus.